Okay, and the next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on actions to increase access, choice and support through drug services in Scotland. The Minister will take questions at the end of our statement, and therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Angela Constance, Minister, around 10 minutes, please. Sorry, Minister, have you got your card in?
You're not going to make me shout, are you?
Minister, 10 minutes from now.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The loss of life in Scotland from drug-related deaths is still as heartbreaking as it is unacceptable. And I offer my condolences to all of those who have lost a loved one. My focus continues to be on doing everything possible to turn the tide on drug deaths. And 2 weeks ago, I updated Parliament on the progress we're making on building capacity and improving access to residential rehabilitation. Today, I'm going to focus on the other main pillar of the national mission, medication-assisted treatment standards. This morning, I had hoped to visit services in Kirkcaldy, specifically to hear about the experience there on setting up same-day treatment and other MAT standards. Sadly, that visit could not go ahead today because of Omicron. From my visits to other areas where same-day treatment is already in place, I have seen and heard about the difference it has made for people. Introducing the MAT standards quickly has improved lives. First, though, I'd like to say a few words about the quarterly figures published today on suspected drug deaths. While these indicate that there may have been slightly fewer suspected deaths over the first three quarters of 2021 than there were for the same period in 2020, as I said to the Chamber in September when the first quarterly report was published, the figures remain high and there is still a long, long way to go. This report is on estimated drug deaths from Police Scotland. It's the second report published this year. It covers July to September. And while this report on suspected drug deaths can't be used to make accurate predictions about the status of the annual report for 2021, which will be about confirmed cases, it helps services respond more quickly to what is needed and will help Parliament monitor progress. And in this vein, I can also announce today that I have approved investment of more than £1.1 million over 3 years and a range of measures to further help monitor progress. Surveillance projects will be developed on a new problem drug use prevalence estimate, a hospital-based toxicology study, and improvements to the National Drug-Related Death Database. All of these projects will improve our real-time understanding of harms to enable faster and better responses. We know that treatment is protective, and my priorities start with getting more people into protective treatment on the back of our commitment to an additional investment of £250 million over the 5 years of this mission. And one of the most significant things we are doing to achieve this is implementing the medication-assisted treatment standards produced by the Drug Deaths Task Force in May 2021, and I am grateful to them for that work. Embedding these across Scotland by April 2022 is a key priority to give people access, choice and support through drug services. The MAT standards set out what people should expect and can demand of services. In June, Parliament agreed that I should provide regular updates and progress. And the first thing I'd like to report on is the launch of our stigma strategy last week. Stigma is a barrier to services for many people, a barrier to the services people have a right to, whether that is residential recovery or to MAT. And the need to tackle stigma is laced through the MAT standards, so this important campaign aims to get everyone to think about and talk about problem drug use in a much less judgmental way as a first step towards ending stigma. I can also report that I have now met with chairs, chief executives and chief officers across the country to get their assurances and commitments to have the standards embedded in a way which will make a real difference to the services people can access from day one. With the support of our national implementation team based in Public Health Scotland, we have helped all authorities assess their readiness, identify where they need extra support and produce project specification documents, which are now being signed off by Integration Authority Chief Officers. I can also report good progress has been made in turning services around to improve access, choice and support. To help with this, we will provide around £6 million for this year to ensure all standards are fully embedded by April 2022. And I have committed to providing over £10 million per year for the next 4 years to ensure the standards are continuously improving. I'd like to highlight some of the key things that funding this year will help achieve. In Fife, we will be providing £300,000 per year to help set up a benzodiazepine-specific treatment service. This new service will directly address the growing risk of benzos contributing to drug deaths, and other areas will be able to learn from this. In Dundee, we are providing £600,000 per year to get more people into treatment through primary care. This is one of a suite of new approaches being taken in Dundee, signalling a change in its service model as recommended by the Dundee Drugs Commission. These examples of new approaches have been made possible by the additional funding which has come with the national mission. As I said to the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee in September, everyone is focused on getting MAT standards properly embedded by April 2022. But the work does not stop there. Over the life of the national mission, we want to see services improving continuously and that this improvement is then sustained for people who need help and support. As you would expect, there will be tough challenges ahead. The implementation team and local services have identified some issues that have to be resolved. There were workforce challenges across health and care even before COVID. There are still some areas relying on very medicalised models of care, even when there is support available from other disciplines and from third sector partners. And we know that there will be particular challenges facing services in rural areas, distances to services for same-day treatment, for example. To overcome these challenges, we are supporting local areas to share best practice on solutions. We are also asking local services to adapt their care models, to be less reliant on traditional medical models of care, to empower local third sector groups to do what they do best, providing flexible local alternatives at pace. And we're also encouraging local areas to adapt their primary care models to get more GP practices and community pharmacies involved in the care for people with problem drug use. This is the sort of flexibility that will be required to make the MAT standards sustainable. And what this will mean is that people will not have to wait days or even weeks to access MAT. Same-day treatment will become the norm. There will also be a wider choice of MAT available, with people having more choice of dosage and long-acting buprenorphine being made more widely available than it has been before. There will be better assertive outreach and anticipatory care in place to help people at high risk either to start or to continue on MAT. And everyone in treatment will be given support to remain in treatment for as long as they need. This is particularly important through transitions from rehabilitation, from hospital and from prison. Services will be psychologically informed and help people grow social networks. Primary care and mental health care will be available alongside MAT, and all care will be trauma-informed, and advocacy and support for housing, welfare and income needs will also be available from MAT services. In my next six-month report to Parliament on MAT in June 2022, I will be able to report on how authorities have moved beyond embedding the standards to improving on them. The implementation team will be working with services in March and April next year to gather evidence that the standards are all embedded. That evidence will be made available. It will be more than just proof that all the necessary processes and structures set out in the MAT standards are in place. And we have already begun training locally to gather evidence of progress from people using the services. Authorities will be relying on the experiential evidence to help show what has improved and to help make further sustainable improvements across the life of the national mission. Presiding Officer, no one should underestimate the scale of the challenge I have set for integration authorities and alcohol and drug partnerships to embed the MAT standards by April 2022. I certainly don't. But these standards will help make people's rights real, and I can report that we have already made good progress towards that. With this progress, we can improve and save lives as part of the national mission by increasing access, choice and support for people through drug services. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will need to move on to the next item of business. As ever, if members wish to ask a question, could they please press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Sue Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I draw the Chamber's attention to my register of interest as a member of the Edinburgh Alcohol and Drug Partnership. 6 months ago, when Scotland's shocking drug death statistics for 2020 were first released, Nicola Sturgeon promised to get a grip on the crisis and pledged an additional £250 million to tackle the drug deaths emergency over the next 5 years. Last week's budget announced that there would be £147.6 million to address the twin public health emergencies of drug deaths and the harms from alcohol, including £61 million specifically to address the national tragedy of drug deaths as part of our commitment to invest £250 million over the lifetime of this Parliament. But this same figure was £145.3 million in 2021-22's budget. And if we were to adjust the budget for inflation, this means the services are in fact facing a real terms cut of about £2.5 million. The First Minister pledged to get it right and provide funding. So where is the additional £250 million that was promised?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I can start on a positive note, it's very useful for me to know that Ms Webber is a member of the Edinburgh Alcohol and Drugs Project, and I hope that will be a useful source of information for both of us going forward. With respect to the budget, can I suggest the member has been perhaps a little mischievous? The First Minister made a very clear commitment at the start of this year for an additional £250 million in addition to core alcohol and drug budgets. And that is reflected in the budget. It was a key manifesto commitment of this government, which we are following through. And I can assure Ms Webber that I am ensuring that every penny of that additional £250 million will be put to maximum use to both save and to improve lives. The Conservatives are, of course, more than welcome to pitch up to Parliament and argue for an extra £1 or £2 million. But I have pitched up to this Parliament with the full support of the First Minister and, crucially, the Finance Secretary, and brought to Parliament £255 million. £5 million at the very start of this calendar year in terms of emergency funding, and that crucial £250 million over the lifetime of the national mission. So we are delivering on our promises to invest and reform services, and I can assure Ms Webber that every penny of that will be put to good use.
Thank you. Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Minister for advance sight of the statement. Today's recorded suspected drugs death figures are a sobering reminder of why we have the statement here today. I hope the reported decrease does mark the start of real improvement, but the fact remains the long-term trend is still moving upward and progress has been too slow. The update today is welcome and the Minister claims good progress is being made, but will the Minister be publishing any data or supporting documents for the progress she has described? It would be instructive, for example, to know how many EDPs are achieving MAT Standard 1 on same-day prescribing. Can I also ask what progress has been made with addressing the high fatality rate linked to street benzos? When in August the Benzodiazepine Working Group issued interim clinical guidance, the report from the Scottish Drugs Task Force today talks about a consensus meeting and then a conference. While I do welcome the specific treatment announcement that's been made for Fife today, in 2019, 70% of fatalities were linked to street benzos. If we are serious about addressing fatalities, the work here must be a priority. And finally, the government must press ahead with safe consumption rooms as part of a package. I know there are barriers, but I don't accept they're insurmountable, and I can ask when the government will bring forward a proposal on this issue.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Ms Baker is quite correct to reflect on the sobering reminder of the suspected drug-related death statistics that were published today. And while they show a small decrease for the first three quarters of this year compared to last year, we have to report those facts as facts, and that there is some care needs to be taken in drawing too many conclusions from those statistics. So she is quite correct that these statistics have to be treated with care, because the bottom line is drug deaths in this country remain far too high. In terms of the data that we will be publishing, I obviously am briefed regularly by my officials. The position is ever-changing, with progress being made week in, week out. But as I outlined in my statement, what we will do is that we will gather the evidence and interrogate that evidence, and roundabout, either prior or at the next six monthly statement progress report that I make to Parliament, we will publish more information so that members can see area by area, standard by standard. But can I also say to Ms Baker, and actually this is an open invitation to other MSPs as well, that if they want to come and engage about progress in any particular area, that I am happy to do that, that we are delving into the detail and scrutinising the delivery of MAT standards in all 30 alcohol and drug partnership areas. The point about benzos is really important. There are plans for a consensus roundtable discussion at the start of the year. This is an area that is quite hotly debated amongst clinicians. I am very keen that we build a consensus upon that, and that we're also in discussions with the UK Government around some legislative opportunities in and around prohibiting the sale and use of pill presses. And in terms of safer drug consumption facilities, we're pursuing two options. We, of course, continue to engage with the UK Government, but our detailed and delicate work about what we can do within our own powers continues. And like Ms Baker, I am absolutely determined.
Thank you, Minister. I'm conscious from earlier statements on this issue that there's a lot of interest around the Chamber and a lot of detail that the Minister can provide, but I'd be grateful, given the number of colleagues that want to get in, to have succinct questions and answers, please, from now on. Gillian Martin, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Problem alcohol and drug use doesn't just affect the person seeking treatment, but the family of the person too, in particular dependent children. I'd like to ask how the Minister is ensuring those who are parents get appropriate treatment choices that take their caring responsibilities into consideration. And the Minister also mentions stigma, of course, the fear of repercussions and stigma for parents with alcohol and drug problems may prevent them from coming forward for treatment. So I'd be interested in a little bit more detail on how that's been addressed as well. Thank you.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I will attempt to be brief. The issue of stigma that Ms Martin has highlighted is of particular importance to overcoming barriers to supporting women to achieve the necessary access to the necessary services that they need. Ms Martin will be familiar with the work that we have undertaken with respect to residential rehabilitation and filling the gaps in services there with respect to women and children. On Wednesday, last week, I launched the framework to improve holistic family support. I did that at the Beacons in Blantyre. And this is about the importance of family-friendly services. But this framework is also backed up with funds totalling £6.5 million. And the Drugs Death Task Force recently published a report on women and drug-related deaths, making a range of recommendations around developing services, collaboration, sharing information and workforce training. And these will be taken forward as part of the implementation of MAT standards.
Thank you. Craig Hoy, to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Between 2006 and 7 and 2015 and 16, cocaine was the main drug of between 5 and 8% of all drug users. But that figure rose to 21% in the most recent data released in March. As part of the national conversation on drugs, what would the Minister's message be to those regular cocaine users, very many of whom believe their use is simply recreational, and who would never, therefore, think of seeking out help, support or treatment?
Minister.
Mr Hoy is quite correct to point to the growing implication of cocaine use in drug-related deaths. It is a matter that I'm paying particularly close attention to, and I've been discussing with a range of services, including the Alcohol and Drug Partnership in my own local area of West Lothian, where there are particular concerns about young men using cocaine on a regular basis, and the particular harms that that is associated with in terms of debt, financial pressures, and also their mental health. There are, in terms of treatment options around for cocaine use, it is imperative that people do come forward to seek help in that regard, and there is a need in terms of cocaine use to have very person-centred approaches, and to quite often to employ more motivational approaches as well, to help people identify the problems that cocaine is causing them in their lives, and to work out person-specific plans to help overcome that.
Thank you. The next three colleagues join us remotely. Firstly, Alistair Allen, to be followed by Katie Clark.
To ask the Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to improve drug services in rural areas where there is often less choice of services, and in particular how third sector organisations such as the Shed Project in my own constituency are being enabled to continue and expand in the vital work they do to support people, including those who are struggling with addiction.
Minister.
I thank Mr Allen for that question. Local initiatives such as the Shed project in his own constituency, which provides drop-in services tailored for people with alcohol or drug-related problems, is absolutely vital to the delivery of services in rural areas. There are specific challenges for rural areas just because of the geography and distances travelled, but nonetheless I am clear that MAT standards have to be delivered in all parts of Scotland, although the solutions for rural areas may need to be more innovative and may need to be more flexible. And that's why the MAT implementation support team are working with a range of rural services to share best practice and are also working hard to find solutions to those unique challenges. And that has also been supported with additional financial resource, which this year was initially identified for £4 million, but has now increased to £6 million.
Thank you. Kerry Clark, to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
I have no doubt that the Minister agrees that it is important to have the community on side with maximum consultation on all aspects of drugs policy. And I know this was raised with her before, when North Ayrshire Council, community councils and the local community found out about the national drugs facility that's intended for Saltcoats in the media. Going forward, could she outline what she thinks she can do to ensure that there's maximum consultation? And also, can she provide an update on what's happening in relation to the Saltcoats facility so that can be shared with the community?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I imagine that Ms Clark is aware that this particular question was covered rather comprehensively in my last statement to Parliament. But can I just reiterate, I have a responsibility to lead a national mission. There were gaps identified in services available to women and families. We sought to address that. I have, of course, engaged with some local councillors in the area, also the local constituency member, Mr Gibson, and can I assure Chamber that Phoenix Futures have a great track record in working with communities, and they have a great track record in saving lives and improving lives, and we can see that in the project, the very similar project that they have run in Sheffield for the past 25 years.
Thank you. Stephanie Callaghan, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, can the Minister outline whether health boards will be encouraged to carry out their own local consultations to ensure that their services are increased? This surely is progressed in a way that best meets the needs and the circumstances of our local service users.
Minister.
Two points I would like to raise, Presiding Officer, is that... GPs with an additional £500,000 this year, and for the life of the national mission to increase and improve their engagement with people with lived and living experience of drug use. And also as part of our specific work around the implementation of MAT standards, as I referred to in my statement, we are recruiting local people so that we can be really bear down on the detail of good qualitative evidence from those who matter most, and that's about people who are trying to access services or people who are in services. So there is investment in peer-to-peer research in this regard that is particularly important.
Thank you. Willie Rennie to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
I do want to thank the Minister for her detailed work. The big question is whether it's enough to meet the enormous challenge that has built up with the highest drug death rate in Europe. There has been a significant increase, as I'm sure the Minister knows, in the number of deaths of homeless people with drug misuse as a major factor. What has she learnt from those deaths? And what plan does the Minister have to improve stabilisation services?
Minister.
I'm very appreciative to Mr Rennie for those questions, because the point about stabilisation services is actually very important, and it relates to the concerns that we have around alcohol but also benzodiazepines, and that whether we're talking about detoxification or stabilising people who are in chaos, are in crisis, that that often needs to be done in supervised environments with the correct medical and clinical support. And we have received a report from the Drugs Deaths Task Force making recommendations around stabilisation services. I've been to visit a few stabilisation services, and we are taking that forward. In terms of the points that he raises around the correlation between homelessness and drug deaths, I think the bottom line for me is we don't have enough people in treatment. And that is on us, and that is why at the very core of our national mission to save and to improve lives is to get more people into treatment. But that means we have to work harder to prevent people becoming homeless in the first place, but also work harder to reach people who are perhaps further away from services. And Mr Rennie is quite correct to point to the scale of the challenge, but we can make a difference. These deaths are avoidable and preventable. There is evidence around the world about what we need to do.
Thank you. We've got 3.5 minutes and four speakers, so as briefly as possible, Stuart McMillan to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister provide an assurance that abstinence-based rehabilitation centres operated via religious organisations will also qualify for funding to help provide increased choice for people seeking assistance?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, faith-based residential services are included in the scope of residential rehab funding. Obviously, in terms of transparency and accountability, you know, there needs to be clarity about how faith informs the model of care, and we would expect all providers to be equal opportunity providers. But I value the role of the faith communities in terms of service provision, and I also think there's a role for faith communities in terms of winning hearts and minds.
Gillian Mackay to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister mentioned the interaction between stigma and medical assisted treatment in her statement. I appreciate the detail of the stigma strategy is probably too much to go into here, but in practical terms, could I ask what work is underway to directly engage with those who would benefit from medical assisted treatment, and particularly those who may suffer with multiple stigma?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, perhaps I can point to the fact that in terms of the media campaign that's aimed at tackling stigma, that was carefully developed over a not inconsiderable period of time with people with lived and living experience. I think as we go forward with the national mission, I think there is more to do to address the stigma that people in the workforce feel, and there is more to do to address the stigma that families and communities are adversely affected by too.
Thank you. Brian Whittle to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think the Minister obviously initially quite rightly focuses on preventing death in the most acute drug addiction cases, but there is also a need to prevent people from falling into that position in the first place. Does the Minister agree that we need to coordinate our resources use that data to deploy them in the most effective manner, including a greater integration between statutory and third sector services, and should be aware of my view on funding the third sector effectively.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I hope that Mr Whittle is well aware of my view that we absolutely have to have an acute focus on prevention and education, and we do, and that I hope he is aware of my views of the value and the role and the potential of the third sector in this country, and that's why there have been funds of £11 million announced this year.
Thank you. And Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Minister's announcement this afternoon, and she will know that the Criminal Justice Committee has been taking evidence on the challenges faced by people previously accessing drug services and who are now in prison. In our recent pre-budget scrutiny work, committee members recommended, among other things, investment in recovery cafes in prisons. So can I ask the Minister to what extent the action she's outlined today will support the ongoing work by the Scottish Prison Service to respond more effectively to prisoners with a drug dependency, and will there be the injection of funds in the recovery cafes
Minister.
That the committee asked for?
So again, Presiding Officer, I would point to the funds that are available to the third sector in this regard. I have visited recovery cafes most recently at Perth Prison. I've recently met the Addiewell Recovery Cafe at the recent annual recovery walk, and MAT implementation support team is very focused in working with the National Prison Care Network as well to ensure that access to MAT is not compromised and that people within prison have the same access to MAT standards. But I'm very much in support of recovery cafes. We fund organisations such as the Scottish Recovery Consortium and Cisco Sustainable Interventions Support and Change Outside to carry recovery work in prisons, and that they bring that lived experience from local recovery communities into prisons to provide things like peer mentoring support, and they're very valuable indeed.
Thank you very much, and apologies to Monica Lennon for not being able to call it. Point of order, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I apologise to the Chamber. I omitted to remind the Chamber of my declaration of interest as a board member of Moving On Inverclyde, which is not a faith-based organisation.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. That is now on the record. There will be a short pause as the front benches change.